In this tutorial, you'll learn how to bounce off of entities. This can be used for enemies like in Super Mario, or for more utility things like springs and launch pads. This method is flexible and allows for a lot of customization. Howdy, and welcome to Game Endeavor. Learn practical dev skills and improve the quality of your games by subscribing and ding-a-linging that bell. When trying to bounce on enemy heads, you may find that it can be a little tricky to implement. It needs to be precise so that your bounce height is always the same. And you have to be perfect, otherwise you could fall through the enemy and damage the player. We're going to fix these issues and more, so let's go ahead and get started. To detect entities under the character, we're going to be using raycasts. So I have a Node2D named Bounce Raycast that will contain our raycast2Ds. It's important that this is a Node2D because nodes do not store transform data. Therefore, any of its children that have the Node2D transform would be left behind at the world's origin. Inside of this node, we'll create a raycast2D that will detect what we can bounce on. Make sure to position its origin inside of the character's collision. For the sake of convenience, I will have mine inset by exactly 1 pixel. Don't bother enabling it, and the cast2 property won't matter either. We'll cover why shortly, but feel free to lower it to something less obnoxious. For the collision mask, I'm going to have a layer dedicated to bounceable objects. I'll be using an Area2D for the bounce area, so I will go ahead and enable area detection for the raycasts. Once you have your raycast set up, go ahead and duplicate it however many times you like and move them into position. Generally, you should be good with at least 3 if your character isn't too wide. Place 1 in the center and 1 on each side. For the bounce area itself, I'm going to create a new scene with the Area2D as the root. The purpose of this scene is to store some settings and allow for us to make changes in one place should we ever need to. I will unset the mask since it doesn't need to detect anything. Unset the default collision layer, instead adding it to the bounce layer so that it can be detected by the raycasts. And then we'll add a small script to the area. The purpose of this script is just to make it easier for us to get the node that this should affect. So inside of it, we'll create an export variable named EntityPath with the Node2D hint, and default it to dot dot, which will refer to its parent. Then, we'll create an onReady variable named Entity and set it to getNodeEntityPath. This is the variable we use whenever we want to get the affected node. And that's it for the area. We just need to instance it onto an entity that we would like to bounce on, and then add a shape. With the scene setup done, we can go into our player script and start putting the logic behind this. We'll start by caching our raycast group into a variable named bounceRaycast. We're then going to create a method for this checking our raycast, which will be named checkBounce, with a delta as a parameter. We're going to call this during the physics process, just before our call to move and slide. In the method, we'll create an if condition checking if velocity.y is greater than 0, because we only want to bounce if our character is moving downward. We'll say, for raycast in bounceRaycast.getChildren, which will cause us to iterate through each of the children of our raycast container. I said earlier that the cast2 doesn't matter. This is because we're going to be adjusting it automatically. If you set cast2 to be a certain length, then you're going to run into some issues. If it's too short, then the character can fall through the enemy and take damage because they're moving further than the distance checked. If it's too long, then they'll bounce off of the entity despite not being close enough to it. We want the length of the raycast to be just right. Well, we know how fast we're going to move this physics process, velocity times delta. So we don't need to check any further than that, and we shouldn't check any less than that. We'll set raycast.cast2 equal to vector2.down times velocity times delta. We're multiplying by vector2.down because we only care about the y-axis. Remember, though, that I had us inset the origin of our raycast by 1 pixel, so we'll need to add that in by adding vector2.down. Otherwise, it'll be short 1 pixel. Raycast2Ds do not update instantly. They do all of their magic after the physics process has ended. But we want to know the results of the raycast now with its new cast2. We can force the raycast to update by saying raycast.forceRaycastUpdate, which is why we didn't need the raycast to be enabled. Calling this method will get the info we need regardless of whether the raycast is enabled or not. Now that the raycast has been updated, let's go ahead and put it to good use. We'll start by checking if raycast.isColliding to see if there's anything we should check the bounce against. We also only want to bounce on top of an entity. Therefore, we'll add an AND condition and check that raycast.getCollisionNormal needs to be equal to vector2.up. This means that the surface of the bounce area needs to be perfectly flat and pointed straight up. If you intend to include any angles in your shape, then you will want to use the dot product to set an angle range. If we're inside of this if condition, then our raycast has detected a surface that we should bounce on. So we're ready to bounce. However, if we do so here, the character has not actually made contact with the surface. Where we'd bounce at would vary based on where we detect the collision, meaning that our jump height would be inaccurate. For some games, this may not be important, But if you're making a precise game that speedrunners might play, then you need accuracy, so let's fix this. Basically, what we want to do is move the character down onto the surface first. Since our raycast length is based on our velocity, any collision we detect is within the distance we were going to move this frame, so we can move ourselves directly onto the surface. To do this, we're going to modify our velocity so that when move and slide gets called, it'll place us precisely on the surface. We'll set velocity.y equal to raycast.getCollisionPoint minus raycast.globalPosition, which is the displacement from the raycast origin to the surface. Don't forget the inset, so we'll remove an extra pixel by subtracting vector2.down. We only care about the y value, so we'll wrap this up in parentheses and get the y value out of the result. Now, when we give this value to the move and slide method in a moment, it's going to multiply velocity by delta to move the character, which means it's going to move a fraction of the distance we want it to move, specifically that distance in 1 second. We want it in one process. So as an act of rebellion, we're going to divide our value by delta, so that when it gets multiplied by delta, it will equal the distance we want it to move. This places us on the surface, but we still need to bounce. We can't do it this frame, because technically we haven't even moved to the surface yet, not until move and slide gets called. So instead, what we're going to do is wait until next process to bounce. We'll do this by using a deferred call. This is going to seem a bit silly, but hopefully it'll make sense. We're not going to bounce directly from our character script. Instead, we're going to tell the entity that we would like to bounce on it. So we'll say raycast.getCollider.entity.callDeferred be bounced upon, and we'll pass self as an argument so that it knows what it wants to bounce. Remember that entity is the property that we set in our bounce area. Before we go deal with that, we've bounced. Therefore, there's no longer any need to check the rest of our raycast. So we're going to break out of this loop. Now we can step into the script of whatever we're bouncing on. For this demonstration, I'm going to use a simple spring object that will animate when bounced upon. We'll create our beBouncedUpon function with the bouncer parameter. And this is where we'll handle exactly what happens when we bounce. Doing it this way allows us to set custom behaviors for the entity being bounced upon. For example, after we've bounced on the spring, it's going to remain here. But if it were an enemy, then we might want to play the enemy's death logic. Or we could have a spring that bounces us even higher than the standard spring. But here's why I said it's going to seem a bit silly. We're actually going to pass the bouncing logic back to the player, simply because I like for the logic that controls the player to be contained within the player. So we'll say if bouncer.hasMethodBounce, then bouncer.bounce. And once that's done, we'll tell the animation of the spring to play the boing animation. But again, there's all kinds of logic you could do here to customize your game. Back in our character script, we'll create the bounce function. We're going to have an optional parameter here so that we can tell our player how high of a bounce we desire. The optional parameter will be named bounceVelocity, and I'm going to set it to a constant named bounceVelocity, which I will define at the top of the script. And then we'll set velocity.y equal to bounceVelocity. If you want to learn more practical developer skills, then watch this video on specifying our jump height and duration, which you can use to set the bounce height for this tutorial. And if you're new, then join the sub club to get notified for future videos.